The terror attack in New Zealand has left Muslims around the world shaken and angry, some of whom who were already concerned about what they call an anti-Muslim sentiment. I'm joined now by CNN.com opinion contributor Dean Obeidallah and human rights lawyer Arsalan Iftikhar. Good to see both of you.
Good to see you.
So, Dean, you recently wrote an op-ed on CNN.com, and you talk about initially your feelings, you know, of disgust and heartbreak, and then how that evolved into anger. Explain to me, you know, this evolution of feelings upon this horrible tragedy.
Sure. And I just want to say first, for the outpouring of support of so many people for our community on Facebook and social media, I want to say thank you. It means much more than you might realize. It meant more to me than I thought it would. And I'm not even part of the New Zealand community, obviously, but for our entire community that was going through a challenging day, to say the least. And it was heartbreaking and disgusting and disturbing. And then that turned to anger. And the anger comes from the point that myself, not just me, others in my community have been calling for years to push back against the anti-Muslim bigotry of people on the right. Donald Trump didn't start that. He just had brought it to a different level. And so we've seen that. We've seen the ginning up of hate. And we've warned that these words can actually inspire people to do horrible things. And this is our greatest concern. Secondly, the media coverage, as quantified by University of Alabama study last year, shows that incidents involving Muslims, who are the bad people, get about 350% more media coverage than when the terrorist is a non-Muslim, even when they're attacking my community, the Muslim American community in this country. So we don't get the press coverage about that, which again, perhaps would have alerted authorities worldwide, because we don't live in a vacuum anymore, that anybody spewing white supremacy online intertwined with anti-Muslim bigotry should be watched, should be checked. And I think that's where the anger comes from, that on some level we felt this could have been prevented if people had heard our calls for years now.
And, you know, this outpouring of condemnation has been, you know, measured, Arsalan, in so many different ways. The president of the United States did come out, you know, with a statement, and he did call the attacks monstrous and horrible. But then there's been a lot of criticism of him that he still hasn't specifically condemned the anti-Muslim motivations. How important is that for you to hear from the president?
Well, Fred, I think it's important to keep in mind, again, like Dean said, that words matter. You know, Donald Trump once famously told Anderson Cooper on CNN that I think Islam hates us when running for the Republican presidential nomination. We all know that he once called for the total and complete shutdown of all Muslims entering into the United States. He was the one who started the birther controversy against President Barack Obama, you know, with the whisper campaigns of him being some sort of crypto-Muslim Manchurian candidate. And what we've seen here with this recent you know, New Zealand mosque massacre is that the perpetrator, the chief perpetrator, was a fan of Donald Trump's. You know, there was a couple of years ago in 2017 in Quebec City, Quebec in Canada, another Trump supporter named Alexander Bissonnette slaughtered six innocent Muslims while they did the morning dawn Fajr prayers. And he had searched for Donald Trump 819 times on the internet and posted selfies with the Make America Great hat on. And, you know, obviously last fall we saw the Tree of Life Synagogue Anti-Semitic Terrorism Act in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. So again, you know, as a human rights lawyer, for me, an attack on one house of worship is an attack on all houses of worship.
But I don't necessarily hear you saying, you know, the president should be shouldering some of the blame, but you're saying, you know, it can't be overlooked that there have been these references made by people who have been carrying out terrible deeds, that they do make some reference or pledge some sort of allegiance to the president in so doing?
Well, I mean, if you look at it again, you know, the rise of white supremacist terrorism, you know, it has not been exclusive to attacks on mosques or synagogues. We saw the Charlottesville protests, you know, in my home state of Virginia, you know, where Donald Trump, you know, said that, you know, there's blame on, quote, many sides of the issue. And so, again, it's important to keep in mind that words matter. And, you know, when hateful rhetoric has become weaponized to the point where you see these mass murder attacks, you know, that's something that all people of conscience need to speak out against.
Mm-hmm. And so, Dean, it may not be as far as pledging an allegiance, but perhaps it's a mention of the president's name. You also wrote in the Daily Beast, you know, another piece, and you say point blank, you know, I'm quoting now, there is no doubt Trump's failure to say any kind words about Muslims was by design. Trump understands that would likely upset his base, whom he has fed a diet of anti-Muslim hate, from declaring that Islam hates us to calling for a total ban on Muslims coming to this country. So further elaborate on your thoughts and why you feel that way.
Sure. I mean, Donald Trump's tweet yesterday very clearly said, I stand with New Zealand. That's great sentiment. However, 49 people who were killed were all Muslims in their house of worship. Donald Trump should have tweeted, I stand with the Muslims of the world, or I stand shoulder to shoulder with Muslims. That was by design. Donald Trump didn't do that because Donald Trump knows his base. He knows the GOP base has been marinating in anti-Muslim hate for years. Donald Trump just brought it to a different level. That's why, in my view, Donald Trump is the anti-Muslim bigot in chief. We've never seen someone call for the ban of Muslims, an entire faith group coming into this country. And the crowd cheered, and 65% of GOP primary voters supported a total ban. So him not saying any nice words about Muslims, saying I stand with them, and secondly, not using the words white supremacist terrorism. That's what I want to hear. He demanded Hillary Clinton and all of us say radical Islamic terrorism, because you can't cure it if you don't say, well, Donald Trump, if you're listening, say the words white supremacist terrorism. But he won't, because his playbook from 2016 was to cozy up with white supremacists by retweeting people with Twitter names like white genocide and not denouncing David Duke when Jake Tapper asked him point blank on this network to do it, and of Charlottesville, and the list goes on. So it's a dangerous playbook. It's a wake up for all of us that this could be a scary, scary time between now and 2020.
All right, Dean Obeidallah, Arsalan Iftikhar, thank you so much to both of you. Really appreciate your candor.
Thanks.